Oh wow. Here I am talking to people who listen to TED Talks. I've given many public talks in the past, but it's usually to rooms full of software engineers, and they're easy to impress. Now I'm in front of people who actually listen to TED Talks, and that is exciting and terrifying, because TED Talks is quality. It's not just ideas worth spreading. TED brings together the best speakers. TED Talks are fantastic speakers, and they got great ideas they want to share with you. They have a fantastic way of presenting it. TED requires quality, demands quality. We received a list of what we have to do and how to prepare for this and what we may and may not do. And when you come to a TED Talk, you can expect to hear some of the best speakers in the world, and me. When I was asked to do this talk, I said, yes, sure, I'd love to. I'll tell you what, I'm going to talk about quality. I am going to give a talk on quality to people who are used to hearing the best quality talks. I wasn't drunk, I must be crazy. Why would I want to talk about quality? It's very simple. I believe quality needs to be the main focus of whatever you are doing. Whether it is in your private life or professionally, I'm going to focus more on the professional side. But whatever product you are building, whatever service you are delivering, I can find it somewhere else. And I can probably find it cheaper. But the quality you produce, that's yours. No one can take that away from you. When I started work some 40 years ago, We had a principle that to remember that a happy customer might tell one other person, an unhappy customer will tell 10 other people. It was a good way to remember that if you make a mistake, you have to get 10 happy customers to balance the effect. Of course, today those numbers are meaningless. If you have an unhappy customer today, within seconds, at the speed of electricity, they're not going to tell 10, they're going to tell 100, 1,000, 1,000,000 people. There is no room today for bad quality. You cannot catch up your mistakes. And it's not going to get easier. Connectivity is increasing. And I just don't just mean technical connectivity, people connectivity. You can talk to anybody in the world now, immediately. You can get reactions. I want to go and see a film. I know someone somewhere likes the same kind of films I like. I can go online and find out, you saw the film, what did you think? You didn't like it, I'm not going to go see it. It's that easy. And it is global. And the global aspect means that your marketplace is global. Your products and services, you can sell to anybody in the world immediately. If you are developing something like software which can be sent over the internet, you don't have to be anywhere near your customer. If you're selling something more hardware-oriented, like cars, there are shipping facilities. You can get it anywhere. You can sell it anywhere. It is extraordinary. But if the market is global, remember your competition is global. You are competing today against people in China and in India, in Brazil and in Mexico. There are people in East Asia, in South Africa, in North America, in West Europe who want your business, who want your customers, who want your revenue. They want your job. They don't care about you. You're not their neighbor. They care about getting your job from you. They care about getting your business from you. opportunity to deliver that quality. One of the most surprising statistics I discovered recently is that a majority of startup companies, of new companies, at least in England, are failing because of too much success. They are failing because they are successful, because I've created a product, I've created something new, and it's working, and it's selling, and people are buying it, and I can't quite keep up, so I hire people. They don't have my dream, they don't have my vision, but they're good technicians, they're starting to work on it. They're not willing to work 25 hours per day, but they're doing a good job. But the customers keep on coming in, and I can't keep up. I don't have the resources to keep up with everyone. What am I going to do? I've basically got two choices. I've got a big multinational who wants to buy my product, and I have to say, sorry, I can't sell to you, I've got no more room. That's difficult. What most companies are doing is saying, I'll take on the new customer, and the old ones, they'll remember the good times. I can take off some of my more skilled people, put them onto the new customers. I can reduce the quality of my service a little bit for them. They'll stay with me, won't they? They won't. They've got a world full of competitors to choose from. So there comes a moment where you've suddenly got to find the impact and say, right, I need to improve, I need to change the direction and recapture the reputation for high quality which I used to have. How do I do that? What do I have to do? I don't know. My job is building widgets. How do I change this? And so I go and read the books. There are lots of books and theories and principles, great ideas. Read these books. They're wonderful. And you read them and you think, yes, I get it. That's what I want. That's the way we should be working. Absolutely. But how do I translate my reality into that theory? Yes, I would like to work like that, but how do I get there? And so the next step is to call in the consultant. Let's pretend it's a good consultant. And the consultant is going to come in and he's going to look at your organization and he's going to analyze things. He's going to identify what you're doing well, what you're doing badly, and he's going to hopefully differentiate the cause from the effect. And he's going to give you a plan of things you should be doing and things you should be improving on. And he's going to talk to your staff and motivate them and yes, we want this. And you got everybody rearing to go, and then the consultant goes away. And real life takes over again. The priority is dropping off. The enthusiasm goes away. What are we going to do? I know. Let's have an audit. Audit gives me a real project. Now I've got it, see, because I've got a due date, I've got a checklist, I've got things I have to do to implement, and it all has to be done for that day, so we've got a real project going and we can really make it happen. An audit is a bit like an exam. Remember your school days. Some of you, that might be fairly recent. For me, it's a little bit back. What is the question you are most likely to ask? Was it, excuse me, teacher, will this additional bit of information make such a big difference on my education that it will make it easier for me to provide happiness to my loved ones and improve the world around me in future years? Or did you ask, teacher, is this going to be part of the exam? What happens when you do an auditor, when you get to an audit, is you start focusing on what the auditor wants. You move away from remembering what your customers want, and you move towards what the auditor wants. And you fill out the checklists. And you do the wrong thing, or you do the right thing for the wrong reasons. In both cases, it doesn't work. You pass the audit, you haven't resolved the problem. It's probably the fault of the model, or the framework, or the theory you apply. So you start using different ones, you compare them, and you take on board a whole bunch of different models and frameworks and theories. They all fail. What happens? When talking about process improvement or quality improvement, we often use the same triangle. It's a triangle that brings together people, process, and technology. And the explanation is usually given that these three items need to be synchronized. I've even heard it said it's like a three-legged stool. If one leg is wobbly, or too long, or too short, your stool falls over, you can't use it. But that's not what this triangle is about. This triangle is saying something a lot more important. Process, that's your work practices. It's not documentation, it's the way you do things. Technology are the tools you use. Technology is what you use to do the things you do. And the most important aspect is people. People are those who use the tools that you use to do the things you do, to do the things you do. People are the ones who produce quality. All your theories and models and frameworks are focusing probably on either process or technology. Very few of them focus on people. People produce the technology, the quality, the good quality and the bad quality. So the question you should be asking is, what is people? People are extraordinary. They're your biggest asset. You are a unique combination of your genetic material, your ancestry, combined with everything that you have eaten, everything you have drunk, everything you have consumed. Combined with every book you have read, every film you have seen, every song you have heard. All this combines, brings together you as a unique individual. Not easy to manage like a bit of technology because you are different from everybody else. And you are carrying around in your brain the most powerful computer that exists in the world. This is an extraordinary computer. It's more powerful than anything we have developed, and it has the added advantage that it comes with a useful body for carrying it around. But it's not just people I want. I want engineers. What's an engineer? An engineer is a person who looks at the world, who examines and measures the world, and uses that information in order to design, create, build a new product. Something that will make life easier for someone. So if we want quality, we're going to hire the best engineers and we're going to shove them into this bizarre concept which is based on an ancient patriarchal system of kings and barons in which we're going to hope that the engineer does something useful. Most large companies have forgotten why they exist. They have forgotten the purpose of the service they're trying to deliver. They have a small group of people who are building the widgets that they want, or driving the software they need, and a large group of people who are controlling things. As a result, promotion becomes the objective, not performance. Stress increases. Stress is a very serious illness which comes from being continuously controlled, measured, and not being able. It doesn't come from too much work. It comes from being out of control. It increases your levels of adrenaline and cortisol, which reduce your body's resistance to illness, which have a negative impact on your memory, reduce your performance, reduce your quality, reduce your usefulness. So, my objective is let's get rid of this and replace it with a system based on knowledge. I would like your project managers to get together and discuss how to solve their problems like engineers do. I would like your software developers to get together and discuss how to improve the quality of software like engineers can do. They know what could be done, what should be done, what would be done. They know what is wrong. I would like your team members to hire new team members that will fit in. It's not your human resource department who should be doing that. You should be doing that yourself. Hire your colleagues. Get rid of management by putting in place the self-controlling, the self-managing teams. I am no longer trying to please my manager. I can focus on pleasing my customer. And that is a lot more important. I can bring the decision level down to the people who actually need to implement it, rather than waiting for hierarchy to transfer the message up and down and do what they think management wants. As far as I am concerned, management should focus on hiring good people and giving them the means to do their job. Leadership means I'm meant to hire people who are smarter than I am. My job is to motivate them and then to trust them to do their work completely. What I have been seeing for the past 40 years in most companies is interference, and that does not help anybody. But then again, what do I know? I'm just